Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is my great pleasure to stand in front of you to present this topic under the guidance of my mentor, Dr. Langenen. By way of approach to the topic, there will be an introduction. We'll talk about the cardiovascular adaptation to pregnancy. There will be general consideration that we'll look at, then the management in all phases of management. Then we'll look at the various cardiac conditions, conclusions, and then I'll show you my references. Worldwide, the incidence of cardiac diseases in pregnancy is between 0.5 and 2%. It is associated with significant morbidity and mortality. It accounts for about 5 to 10% of all deaths in South Africa. Rheumatic and congenital heart diseases account for the majority of cases in pregnancy. So I'm sure after presenting this piece of statistics, you would agree with me that a proper approach to the management of cardiac disease in pregnancy is of paramount importance. Despite all the statistics that I've presented, there is a significant outcome if there is proper preconception, antenatal and intrapartum postpartum management.
Thank you, Loris. This slide is just to demonstrate the background of cardiac disease in our drainage area. This is an order from 2013, and the total patients seen in the clinic was 318, first visits 138. So this is all outpatients clinic. So if you're in Worcester or Paul and somebody gives a history of heart disease, in the past all the heart diseases came to level 3, or the patient said she had rheumatic heart disease before, we then follow them up at the clinic and make a management plan. Of these patients, only 180 patients stayed in the level 3 follow-up system. 21 patients were referred back to Paul, 53 patients referred back to level 1, and 32 patients had no pathology. This does not include the inpatients. If it's after hours, the cardiac patients will be admitted and seen by the team, and it does not include the OCU admissions, but roughly it's about 50% of 690 admissions during 2015. And it does also not include the patients admitted to acute postnatal. Just to give you an idea of the primary pathology, so the most important pathology in that patient, patients with congenital ASDs or VSDs, 26 patients, and 6 of these was combined. That's a difficult lesion to manage. Patients with tetralogy of Fallot, 13 patients just in 1 year, and 3 of these was uncorrected, very difficult to manage. Patent ductus arteriosus foramen fall in 9 patients. Stenotic lesions, very common in our area. Some of them congenital, most of them due to rheumatic heart disease. We did 8 valvuloplasties where these patients went to term and had no complications. Incompetent lesions, 18 mitral valve or aortic valve replacements, 13 patients with cardiomyopathies, 15. Pulmonary hypertension, the ones that we are interested in, is the one, there's some secondary to mitral stenosis, they usually do well, but we had patients with pulmonary hypertension secondary to tetralogy of Fallot and due to pulmonary causes. And then other patients was rheumatic heart disease, a disease of no lesion that was sent out, or they were sent in for a murmur and sent out. And then the mortality, there was only one mortality, and 1 year mortality, a patient, Samantha Boudrum, was still here. Patient acute collapse in the cardiac clinic, was rushed to OCU, CPR, babies, she had to pulse back within 4 minutes. She did a perimortem cesarean section as well, and the patient had intact survival. So this is a very low mortality rate for a busy service. Over to you.
Having said all of that, let us explore the cardiovascular adaptation to pregnancy. The primary event is the peripheral vasodilation. This is mediated by the endothelial dependent factors, including nitric oxide synthesis, which is upregulated, and by estrogen and vasodilatory prostaglandins. This leads to a fall in the systemic vascular resistance, increase in cardiac output. This is achieved by increase in stroke volume and heart rate. As you know, that cardiac output is a product of stroke volume and heart rate. By 8 weeks of gestation, cardiac output has already increased by 20%. The maximum levels are reached at between 20 and 28 weeks of gestation. There is a minimal decrease at term. Though the stroke volume tends to lower down at term, it is not significantly noticed because there is an increment in the heart rate between 10 and 20 beats per minute, and then in that way it preserves the increase in cardiac output. The supine position, it actually puts pressure on the inferior vena cava, and in that way it decreases the venous return and bringing a reduction of about 25% in cardiac output. There is a reduction of in cardiac output which is associated with decrease in uterine blood flow and placental perfusion, and that compromises the fetal blood supply. Pulmonary edema will be precipitated if there is an increase in cardiac preload, that is if you're using fluids excessively, or increase in pulmonary permeability, as it is the case with preeclampsia. Labor is associated with further increase in cardiac output. In the first stage of labor, you've got an increment of about 15%, and in the second stage of labor, about 50%. Uterine contractions, they also contribute by way of auto-transfusion, about 300 to 500 mils of blood. Sympathetic response as related to pain and anxiety also brings the heart rate and the BP up. The cardiac output increase during and in between contractions. Following delivery, immediate increase is noticed in terms of cardiac output due to the relief in the relief in the inferior vena cava obstruction. Okay. This is just a summary of what I've already alluded to. There are normal findings on examination of the cardiovascular system in pregnancy. That one would mean these include the bounding or collapsing pulse, ejection systolic murmur, loud first heart sound, relative sinus tachycardia, ectopic beats, peripheral edema, ECG. There are some ECG changes, atrial and ventricular ectopics. The Q wave is small, and the inverted T wave in the third in lead number 3. ST segment depression and T wave inversion in the inferior and lateral leads. General considerations would be to look into the pre-pregnancy counseling. That plays a very, very important role in terms of managing a patient in labor. The management of a patient in labor predates as far back as the preconceptual period. In that period, a detailed assessment of a cardiac status is of necessity. The potential risks are identified before conception. That includes also looking into the medication of the patient. The big concern in our community is the unplanned pregnancies. Whatever the underlying cause of cardiac insufficiency, the ability to tolerate pregnancy or labor in particular depends on the hemodynamic significance of any lesion, and also the presence of pulmonary hypertension, the functional class, that is the New York Heart Classification, the presence of cyanosis, the history of transient ischemic attacks or arrhythmias, the history of heart failure. But each case must be individualized.
This is just to demonstrate if a patient is referred to the cardiac clinic, for instance, they will first be examined. If it's a physiological murmur, we will not do an echo. If you see this, you are happy. This is the para-axis long sternal view, so it's just the echo, the The probe will take a slice, mainly showing you the left ventricle. Here you can see the left atrium, that's of normal size, that's a good sign. If there's any pressure changes, it will enlarge. Then the left ventricle, and if this is unfortunately not working, but you'll be good contractile function, let's say aortic valve, and then the blood will pass through the aorta, and that's the right atrium. So if you see that, just to show you normal, we will show you some abnormal pictures later.
Over to you. Okay. Thanks. There are some special considerations to take into cognizance. With mitral stenosis, there's a high risk of pulmonary edema. With Marfan syndrome, there is a risk of aortic dissection or rupture. Pulmonary hypertension, there's a risk of death, which is about 40% in some cases. Also, there are complex congenital heart diseases. The mechanical heart valves, they have got a risk of thrombosis. Management of patient in labor now. The management can take place in a level 2 hospital if it's a low risk situation, or preferably at tertiary level if it's a high risk patient. There are normal principles that need to be adhered to. We avoid prolonged labor, and cesarean section is only indicated for obstetric reasons. The first stage of labor, the position is important, modified Fowler's position. Oxygen, use an open mask at the flow of a rate of 4 liters per minute. The fluids that you use, 200 mils bag of normal saline or Ringer's lactate, using a 60 dropper, administered, our administration set to run at 10 to 20 mils per hour. We use infusion pump or IVEC. Analgesia is quite important, and epidural analgesia is recommended. But also, there is an alternative of pethidine together with Atarax. Monitoring, we need to monitor the BP and the pulse, and also the input, output, and oxygen saturation. Augmentation, you avoid rupturing of membranes. Use oxytocin, 10 international units in 200 mils normal saline. The caution is that you must take care of the antidiuretic effects of oxytocin. If there is no progress or poor progress after 2 hours after initiating of oxytocin, then a cesarean section is indicated. Antibiotics, prophylactic antibiotics for infective endocarditis is no longer routinely given. It is actually reserved for those patients who are at high risk, like a patient with previous infective endocarditis. Resuscitation, always keep an emergency trolley at bay for any possible eventuality. Thromboprophylaxis, you continue to give it if the patient was given antenatally. Therapeutic doses should be reduced to the prophylactic dose on the day before induction or cesarean section and continued during labor. When regional analgesia is used, the following guidelines should be followed. One, you should not be used within 12 hours of prophylactic dose. Also should not be used within 24 hours of therapeutic dose. The low molecular weight heparin should not be given within 4 hours after insertion of regional analgesia. Epidural catheter not to be removed within 12 hours after the first dose. That takes us to the second stage of labor. In addition to the usual preparations, ensure the availability of obstetric forceps and ventos, the cardiac defibrillator, drugs, morphine, glycerol trinitrate, furosemide. You need also to bring to make sure that there is laryngoscope, ET tubes, and AmbuSec and oxygen supply. Antibiotic prophylaxis is indicated if there is a prosthetic heart valve or recent or current rheumatic fever, manual removal of placenta, prolonged labor, more than 12 hours, forceps delivery or trauma during delivery, or cesarean section. During delivery, you need to ensure that the patient is not in lithotomy position. Patient is put in a semi-Fowler position, and the legs are put at the edge, the feet are put at the edge of a chair. you avoid routine episiotomy. You minimize maternal bearing down and can use Wrigley's forceps or Ventos delivery as an assistant. The third stage of labor, you avoid ergot-containing drugs, syntromethrin. Oxytocin can use 5 international units, IM or slowly IV is recommended. As soon as the uterus contracts, the placenta must be delivered via the Brand Andrews method. The puerperium, the first hour after delivery is quite critical. We monitor the vital signs, you monitor the impending cardiac failure, and blood loss is quite essential. Keeping in high care for a few hours before transferring the patient to postnatal ward. Early mobilization is encouraged to prevent deep vein thrombosis. We continue anticoagulation where it is indicated. That takes us to the various cardiac pathologies. The classification, they are classified as congenital and acquired. Under congenital, we've got the acyanotic lesions and you've got the cyanotic lesions. The acyanotic lesions would include, among others, atrial septal defect and ventricular septal defect. Those are the commonest. The cyanotic lesions would include tetralogy of Fallot and also Eisenmenger syndrome. Others would include coarctation of the aorta. When you're talking about acquired lesions, rheumatic heart disease plays a very important role. That's why we get our mitral stenosis, mitral incompetence, aortic stenosis. The other that we'll talk about are the cardiomyopathies, the peripartum cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy, and there are also valve replacement and pulmonary hypertension. Going through the mitral stenosis, there are key points that one needs to take into consideration. The most common valvular lesion in pregnancy. It also, there is an impediment of blood flow from the left atrium to the left ventricle. Patients with moderate to severe stenosis are most likely to develop cardiac complications. Recommended workup and clinical findings, echocardiogram plays an important role to establish severity of the stenosis and the size of the left atrium. ECG, you would exclude atrial fibrillations. On auscultation, you may get a loud S1, opening snap, and rumbling diastolic murmur.
This is a picture of, in this one, the previous one that we saw before, the left atrium was small. This left atrium is nearly double the size, so it's high pressures. You can see that that pressure is actually pushing back into the pulmonary veins, and that will increase the pulmonary pressures and cause edema. And then, if you have a patient, for instance, a preeclamptic patient with pulmonary edema, and as you're treating them, they just get worse, and you put the echo on, this is a very easy lead to obtain, then we can see there the hockey stick vein. So if it looks like a hockey stick, then you know you probably have a patient with mitral stenosis. So that's a mitral valve. That's only that small area, so severe mitral stenosis, and then the left ventricle and the aorta, and so that patient presented with pulmonary edema. And the most important is rate control and CPAP. This is a picture of the valve that's stenotic. The normal valve should be around that size. So it's a severely stenotic lesion.
Okay, thank you. The potential complication with mitral stenosis, pulmonary edema comes number one. There would also be atrial fibrillations. There would be thromboembolism and stroke. Therapy entails two goals of management. One is to prevent tachycardia, and that is well done by managing pain, beta blockers, and our target heart rate would be less than 100 beats per minute. The second goal is to maintain left ventricular filling. If it's inadequate, then it leads to a drop in cardiac output. And diuretics to treat pulmonary edema. Would also use digoxin to treat atrial fibrillations. Anticoagulation, you consider it if the left atrium is dilated or if there are chronic atrial fibrillations. Anesthetic issues, you would give epidural. that would also help to control tachycardia in labor. Labor and delivery, tocolytics that cause tachycardia are contraindicated for premature labor. Hemodynamic monitoring for severe mitral stenosis is also very important. You would consider assisted delivery in the second stage of labor, and cesarean section only reserved for obstetric indications. With mitral incompetence, it is actually well tolerated in pregnancy. Commonly, it is secondary to mitral valve prolapse. Long-standing regurgitation may lead to ventricular dysfunction or atrial enlargement. Recommended workup and clinical findings do ECG that will help you to assess the severity of regurgitation and evaluate the atrial enlargement and ventricular function to exclude also atrial fibrillation. Potential complications are quite rare, but if they are there, usually it's pulmonary edema or dysrhythmias. There are key avoids that one needs to put into cognizance. Avoid arrhythmia, avoid bradycardia, avoid increase in system vascular resistance. Medical therapy would entail necessary only in the presence of ventricular dysfunction or dysrhythmias. Anticoagulation, you would consider it if the left atrium is dilated or a chronic atrial fibrillation. Anesthetic issue, epidural. And then labor and delivery, consider cesarean section only when it is obstetrically indicated. That takes us to the atrial septal defect. The second arm, ASD, is the most common defect in pregnancy. ASD size and flow across the shunt can worsen during pregnancy. Pregnancy generally is well tolerated. The recommended workup is echocardiogram that will help to evaluate the size of the defect, severity of the shunting, and measure the pulmonary artery pressures. ECG, the partial right bundle block, branch block, right axis deviation, and sometimes the right ventricular atrophy. Auscultation, you're likely to get a systolic ejection murmur at the left sternal border and a wide fixed split second heart sound. There are potential complications, atrial fibrillation, congestive cardiac failure, pulmonary hypertension, and also may lead to Eisenmenger syndrome. There is paradoxical emboli. Medical therapy is necessary in the presence of dysrhythmias. Anticoagulation is not indicated, and cesarean section is only for obstetric indications. Anesthetic issues, epidural is acceptable. Ventricular septal defect, pregnancy is generally well tolerated. There are recommendations and clinical findings, echocardiogram again, to determine the size of the lesion, direction of the shunt flow, estimation of pulmonary artery pressure, and performance of ventricles. ECG usually is normal, but may demonstrate left or ventricular hypertrophy. Auscultation, holosystolic trill, and murmur at the left sternal border. There are potential complications that are similar to those of ASD. There's also congestive heart failure. Medical therapy is only necessary in the presence of dysrhythmias. Labor, cesarean section for obstetric indications. Tetralogy of Fallot. The classical tetrad findings. Ventricular septal defect overriding aorta, right ventricular outflow obstruction, right ventricular hypertrophy. Recommended workup and clinical findings, echocardiogram to establish the cardiac anatomy, to evaluate the valvular and right ventricular function, to assess pulmonary hypertension and measure the aortic diameter. ECG is variable depending on the type of correction that is performed. Medical therapy, antidysrhythmic therapy as needed. Patients may already be on diuretic therapy, beta blockers, or antihypertensive. Anticoagulation, it's not indicated.
The following is a patient with mainly ASD and small VSD that
develop Eisenmenger syndrome. What you look at is your worst nightmare. In this patient, you can see the whole heart is volume overloaded. That large gap, so there's free flow of blood. Unfortunately, so the pressure in the left ventricle, you will have a shunt that direction. You can see that the right atrium and right ventricle is dilated as well. So at times, there's shunt of deoxygenated blood to the that goes up into the that follows this path, goes up into the pulmonary artery, and the patient becomes cyanotic. This is a pressure. It's a pump and pressure dependent. If there's any change in pressure at any of these points, the patient will decompensate and die. So unfortunately for us, the patient's going to labour, their heart rate changes. If you do this Zener section and they have severe hemorrhage, if they become hypoxic, if they develop postpartum hemorrhage, they're in trouble. So these ones, you want to, when the patient's stable, you want to keep everything exactly the same. And there you can see the impact. The left ventricle is working well, but the pressures in that right ventricle are so high that it squashes that left ventricle. So you can see that bulging in, and that's also, we recently managed a patient like this. Very difficult to manage, and due to good team effort, the patient did survive. And that show, that is just a picture, it's not moving, but that's a corrected tetralogy of the load. So it looks basically normal. So the patients with a corrected tetralogy do well, but if there's still severe pulmonary hypertension, they're still at high risk of failure.
Well, just for clarity, the cyanotic lesions are where you have a left to right shunt. A right to left shunt.
So then all this deoxygenated blood will directly go into the
left
left ventricle, left atrium, and pulmonary, and then to the aorta.
Thanks. The anesthetic issues, epidural analgesia, labor, and delivery, Cesarean section, is usually common due to perceived cardiac risk. Talking about peripartum cardiomyopathy now, the criteria for diagnosis is one, development of cardiac failure in the last month or within 5 months of postpartum, absence of identifiable cause of cardiac failure, absence of recognizable heart disease prior to the last month of pregnancy. There are also additional part of criteria, left ventricular systolic dysfunction as manifested by ejection fraction less than 45%, shortening fraction of less than 30%, left ventricular end diastolic dimension of more than 2.7 square centimeters. Slight mistake there, of body surface area. 90% of cases occur in the first 2 months postpartum. Half of death occur in the first 6 weeks postpartum. The risk factors, multiparity, multiple pregnancy, and advanced maternal age, and it's usually common in the Afro-Caribbean race. Pregnancies that are complicated by hypertension.
This is a picture of a patient with cardiomyopathy. We can see the globular dilatation of the heart. If we start, the left atrium is dilated. The clip, the valve is usually, as it dilates, there's usually insufficiency as well. And then we have a left ventricle that's nearly double the size. The slide is unfortunately not working on the program, but this usually what you will see is there's poor contractility. The ejection fraction is low, and poor systolic function. And then on that side, the right heart is involved as well and also enlarged. Important with the one of the advantages if the patients come in the first trimester, and we can identify this, then we can stratify who's the patient at the highest risk and what patient should be terminated. And that's one of the ways to save lives. And the patients that present first with the mitral stenosis, we can often do, or not we, the, in combination with the cardiologist, we can do a balloon valvuloplasty, and that also improves the outcome. And these days, the new kid on the block is that At Tygerberg Hospital so far, they have done in patients with severe mitral stenosis. They've unfortunately not pregnant, but they did 10 total intravascular valve replacements. That is very advanced technology. So they do a heart valve replacement through the artery. Hopefully we will be able to do that in our patients in the first trimester soon too.
Management, elective delivery if antenatal. Thromboprophylaxis is mandatory if there is severe left ventricular dysfunction, if there is intracardiac thrombus or arrhythmias. Conventional treatment for heart failure, including the diuretics, the vasodilators, the cardioselective beta blockers, or beta blockers with anterior vasodilation action, digoxin, inotropes, and ACE inhibitors if it's postpartum. Recommended workup and clinical findings, ECG, is nonspecific. Echocardiogram to establish baseline and repeat and is repeated every trimester or with worsening symptoms. The prognosis depends on the normalization of the left ventricular size and function within 6 months after delivery. That takes us to the conclusion. The approach to the management of labor in cardiac patient, as I indicated earlier on, dates back to the preconception through the antenatal period during labor and also immediate postpartum period. Multidisciplinary approach is quite mandatory. It requires a detailed assessment by the cardiologist, by the obstetricians, and also the obstetric anesthetists. An agreed upon documented plan for delivery is critical. The general and basic principles of management of labor are applied. These principles may be individualized based on the type of cardiac pathology and specific needs of the patients. Thank you. These are my references.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mpika. That was very good. Any questions? Yes, Michelle. I think sort of in our population and even in the European society, I think it's just the principle that you want to try to avoid a patient with prolonged rupture of membranes. But I would say you can individualize and depending on the patient's status, I would say that you can individualize and you can still rupture the membranes. But I think the thought process behind that is to, when you induce a patient, is to try to avoid the rupture of the membranes if it's not necessary to decrease risk of infection. Prof?
Lennox, you suggested the use of vacuum and Lippi's forceps.
Yes.
But on the other hand, you also say episiotomies are contraindicated. You must avoid episiotomies. Does that statement not mean it actually rules out the use of the Lippi's forceps? So if assisted delivery is required, it probably should be a vacuum delivery because the forceps deliveries have more maternal
tears,
vagina, and
yes, Prof. I think the message behind is that it shouldn't be a routine episiotomy where it is not indicated. I think when one is using assisted delivery, inevitably sometimes episiotomy may be necessary. That's how I take it. I don't know whether you...
I think what he meant is... episiotomy for normal indications, but if you're going to do a Wrigley's, then you might end up with more trauma and then you will probably have to do an episiotomy. Just in terms of the second stage of labor, I've looked at it and there's a lot of older obstetrician data and people like to do things the way that we've been doing it. We can't change it if we don't know about something better to do, but you have to individualize. And one of the things that we can do is, I think in our team, that when we have the delivery plan, we can select certain patients that may benefit from assisted delivery. But the majority of the cases, if you just wait, don't let the patient lie flat on the back, semi-fowlers, conduct the labor, don't let her push, just wait until she's in the second phase of the second stage. And try to avoid long-term overbearing. And then the impact is the decrease in venous return. But they do compensate with the tachycardia. So depending on the lesion, if they can compensate with the tachycardia, it's not the end of the world. But if it's a, if it's another lesion that more relies on the preload, then you should do assisted delivery. But the message is just to wait, be patient, and make sure that that last bit is not prolonged. Yes.
Patients,
you have to be, it's a pump that's not working. If you use any drug or if you change that system, then they can potentially decompensate. And if you give that patient a calcium canal blocker, you can also crush the patient. So that's one of the places where if you have a patient like that, we can buy in a Torsiban. We don't have it in the pharmacy, but if you motivate them, they can buy it in from one of the other pharmacies. In hours and after hours, you can buy it in from the hospital. So Torsiban then blocks the receptor and it doesn't have any hemodynamic effects. So in the cardiac patient, the Torsiban then is definitely indicated, not the other ones. Yes.
So post-delivery, you need to fully anticoagulate them again, initially on IV heparin infusion. And I find having epidural in place makes it difficult because we would have to fully anticoagulate them, and then if we want to remove the epidural, let's say on day one or two or three, we're going to have to completely stop the anticoagulation, wait 2 to 24 hours, remove the epidural, and then re-anticoagulate them. I don't know if there's a simpler way around.
The easiest what you can do is, In the patient,
the mechanical valve is intravenous heparin because you can control it. The half-life is extremely short, it's 90 minutes. So if you stop it, coagulation returns back to normal in a short space of time. So around that time, you can stay away from low molecular weight heparin. It's better than to keep your patient on IV heparin when the patient goes in labor. You can stop it, and you can just give a prophylactic dose then of subcut unfractionated heparin. And you can allow for 24 hours peri-delivery. And the most important thing of the epidural is that's often, it's not just to prevent the pain response, but in these patients, there's a lot of volume in the patient's vascular system and during the contraction of the uterus. So the epidural, if you keep the epidural running, then and you decrease it slowly over 12 hours, the highest risk of mortality is in the first 6 and then 12 hours. So then it's slow recruitment of all that volume. So then the patient can adapt. And the epidural can stay in quite long. Epidural can stay in for 36 hours without the increased risk of infection. So then after that time when you wean the epidural off, then you can just stop the IV heparin and you can remove it then 2 or 3 hours later. And then you can choose what regimen you want to use after that.
So they can be fully anticoagulated with the epidural in situ, it's just the in situ.
Yes.